Hey everyone, I'm Prateek, a dentist and specialty doctor, and in this video we're going to look at how to effectively carry out a radiographic assessment of a lower wisdom tooth. If you want to see similar educational content to this, please make sure to subscribe to the channel. By being able to effectively assess and evaluate a radiograph of a lower third molar, we are able to inform our patients more accurately about their clinical scenario. It increases our confidence when it comes to the surgical procedure, and it also helps us identify and predict potential complications. Identifying predicting complications is extremely important. If we identify it early on and we almost predict to the patient that this is a risk of happening, when it does happen, the patient understands because we've warned them. However, if we don't warn the patient of a potential risk or complication, when it comes to it happening, they think we're making excuses about what's happened. Effectively assessing a radiograph isn't just for those who are removing the teeth. It is also important for you if you're considering referring a patient for onwards care, because you have a duty of care towards the patient to identify risks and warn them of it, and also explain why you're referring them in the first place. Additionally, patients may just have questions about what risks are involved, and so it's helpful for you to be able to assess their radiograph and tell them risks that are relevant to them. So when it comes to assessing lower third molars, whether it's on periapical radiographs, on OPTs, whatever it may be, a mnemonic that I like to use is CRAP. So if we break this down, we have C, that reflects the crown of the tooth. So I look at the crown and see, is there any caries, any restorations present? But something like caries will significantly weaken the crown of the tooth, and therefore is liable to fracturing during extraction. Also, under crown, I look at the morphology of the crown. So does it look particularly bulbous, an abnormal shape, anything that may affect the extraction? I then move on to R, which is looking at the roots. So how many roots does the tooth have? Are they developed roots? Are they uncollosed roots? Are there any particular abnormalities with the shape or morphology of the roots? So are there any bends, any hooks in the roots, any bulbosities? Because all of these factors may increase the difficulty in extracting the tooth at the end. We then move on to A. So we have angulation and alveolar nerve. So angulation is looking at the direction that the tooth is sat. Majority of wisdom teeth, when it comes to extracting them, they are impacted into something surrounding them. So we can look at the angulation and the positioning of the wisdom tooth and divide it into several forms. We have horizontal, mesioangular, vertical, distoangular, and rarely you can have a transverse wisdom tooth. By looking at this angulation, we can again potentially predict relative difficulty of removing the tooth. So distoangular wisdom teeth tend to be slightly more difficult to remove because the roots tend to be pushed up against the lower seven, and so there's very little room to either elevate or carry out surgical removal of bone. Additionally, in this portion, we can look at the nature of the impaction that the tooth is experiencing. Is it bony? Is it tooth? Or is it soft tissue, or a combination of these? Also under A is the alveolar nerve, or to be more accurate, the inferior alveolar nerve. This is probably the most important part of the assessment that you're going to do, as this is the risk that most commonly will be at relayed to the patient prior to removal of a wisdom tooth. Additionally, it's probably the risk that has the greatest significance to the patient because of potential implications if that nerve gets damaged. We can see where the nerve travels based on the inferior alveolar canal, which is seen as tram lines going through the mandible. When these tram lines come near the wisdom tooth, there are certain features we look for that may indicate that a wisdom tooth is at higher risk of damaging the nerve. These features include narrowing of the canal or the roots of the tooth, radiolucency or darkening where the roots cross over the canal, loss of cortication of the tramline, so those tramlines vanish near the wisdom tooth, or deviation of the canal or the root, so are the roots hooked away? Is the canal suddenly jutting out of its original course? If you identify any of these features, it is fair to say to the patient that they may be at increased risk of damage to the nerve. It then leads on to a further discussion of potentially further imaging. So this would include potential for a cone beam CT, or even considering other management options, such as coronectomy if it's appropriate. And finally, we have P. So P, again, I divide into two parts, pathology and peripherals. So you have pathology. This is looking at any active pathology surrounding the tooth. So whether it is a cyst, whether it's periapical pathology, it is also looking at things like distal bone loss. In patients who have recurrent pericoronitis in a wisdom tooth, they get some distal bone loss, and this may make it easier to extract the tooth. We then also have the peripherals. So these are just other bits and bobs that you may want to consider when it comes to evaluating the tooth. One of these aspects is looking at how much bone is surrounding the wisdom tooth. If there's lots of bone surrounding the wisdom tooth, for example, a tooth that is lower into the mandible, then it's going to be more difficult to remove. Along with this, we want to look at the density of the bone. The greater the density, the more difficult the tooth will potentially be to remove. And finally, another thing that I like to look at is the lower seven that is adjacent to the wisdom tooth. I like to look at any restorations that are there, i.e. is there a chance that this tooth may be damaged when we remove the wisdom tooth, but also potential restorability of this tooth. Because if this tooth looks like it's unrestorable and should be extracted as well, then it may well be beneficial to take this out first, giving you better access to the wisdom tooth. Now, let's look at some examples. So here we have a portion of an OPT that demonstrates a lower left 8 in a patient. So let's work through the mnemonic and assess this tooth. So firstly, looking at the crown. So there's no obvious caries that I can see, and the crown morphology looks relatively normal to me. Then looking at the roots. So I can identify two obvious roots. We have a distal root that looks relatively straight, and a mesial root that has a slight curve to it. Moving on to the angulation. So looking at this tooth, we can see it's distoangular, and that mesial root is very closely pressed up against the severum. This may add some complexity when it comes to surgical removal. If you also look at the nature of the impaction, looking distally at this tooth, there hasn't really been any bone loss, and therefore it is likely that the nature of impaction is bony and potentially soft tissue as well. Along with this, we look at the alveolar nerve, so we can see the tram lines of the nerve traveling down, and where they cross the apices of this tooth, everything darkens off a little bit. So remembering back to potential scenarios where the nerve is at higher risk of being damaged, darkening of the roots would indicate this. And so, again, this is a potential red flag that we need to raise up to the patient. Finally, looking at the P, so the pathology, there aren't any cysts, there isn't any periapical pathology, nothing else there concerning me. And in terms of the bone that is surrounding the tooth, there's probably a normal level of bone. The severum itself looks relatively healthy. There may be an argument of potentially some distal caries there. However, a bite wing radiograph would be better at assessing this. So based on that radiographic assessment, I can tell the patient that the tooth may be slightly more difficult to remove because of the fact that it's distoangular, there isn't any bone loss, and speak to them about their increased risk of potential nerve damage. So there we've looked at how to assess a lower third molar effectively on a radiograph. So hopefully you can inform your patients more confidently of their risk. Please make sure to like, comment, and subscribe. And if you do have any other suggestions of any videos, please make sure to let me know. Until the next video, take care.